Hello and welcome to today's webinar, How to Use the SDL Tridion Connector Framework. This is the first in a series of three technical webinars where our development team will share in-depth information about the upcoming release of SDL Tridion Sites 9.1. My name's Kate and I'll be your host. And we expect today's webinar will last about 45 minutes, followed by a Q&A session. If you have any questions during this presentation, then can you please pop them in the Q&A box in the Ask a Question tab. I'm now going to pass you over to Ivo to begin the presentation.
Okay, good afternoon. Welcome to this session about the SDL Tridion Integration Framework. My name is Ivo van der Lagemaat. I'm a product owner for SDL Tridion DX. I'm working on the Tridion product for almost 18 years. First started the first 10 years helping programming the content manager side of it. Then I joined the mini manager part. And the last couple of years I'm a product owner for Tridion DX.
Okay, hi, my name is Niklas Heerman. I'm driving connectors for SDL Tridion at SDL. So not that experienced as I was. It was 12 years of experience of Tridion. So it's
okay, today's agenda, so we talk a little bit about the framework, the scenarios, the connectors, how we can develop them, how to deploy them, and the last point is actually the Q&A session. The reason why actually we do this kind of connector, so we have the marketing technical landscape. It consists about more than 7,000 vendors as per April this year. They cover a lot of ground and for advertising and promoting or for commerce and sales, and Tridion itself cannot have that expertise or cannot build a product or enhance it. It just takes too much time, and maybe customers already have those products and then it will be better to integrate with Tridion, or maybe they already have an data or on commerce and sales product and they want to actually consume the data on a CMS system, so that's also a good fit for Tridion DX. So on this landscape, where are we actually? We are in this corner, that red dotted corner. It's hard to find us. If you can find us, let us know, because we cannot find us that easily. So it's our best breed strategy to actually connect to all this kind of vendors to make it possible to consume their data in our product. The integration framework. So the integration framework is just a framework you can consume in multiple places in the product. The framework itself consists mainly on a connector manager. And a connector manager is just more like a library that is hosted in an application, and that application runs on a machine. With that connector manager, we actually can create a GRPC channel to another process. And a GRPC is actually a Google remote procedure calls. It's like a third party product we're using. That gives us the flexibility to talk to another process in another kind of language even. So we can even talk to processes that is running .NET Core or Java clients or Node.js or whatever. It gives us much more flexibility and it listen to the developers that are more experienced maybe in .NET, or maybe they preferred to write those connectors in Java. It is flexible, this kind of architecture as well, because it all basically depends on a contract. And a contract is defined by the application, and the contract has to be also be implemented in the connector. And that way we can actually communicate to each other from the application to the client, and it more or less looks like the application is directly talking to the connector. So from that point of view, we hide all the technical details from you. You only have to implement the connector, register it, and it will automatically be consumed by the application.
So yes, so in the context of Tridion, this means that we have a new agnostic architecture for doing extensions and connectors. So you write connector once, either in C# or Java, and that will run everywhere, including from content management and on the dynamic experience delivery layer. we're going to show some more examples around that later in this talk.
So you also saw, so in the previous slide, you already saw, well, we have a .NET process or a Java process. In that way, we have actually, from the connector manager, we have to launch a process. If you launch the other process, we have to make sure that we already have Java or that .NET Core installed on that machine. Once we actually launch the process is isolated from the application. So if the process or if the connector process gets corrupted or crashes, it does not have any, it does not crash the main application. So we have more or less process isolation, and we have resilience. So if the process dies, we launch a new process with that connector. So we introduce some kind of ping mechanism, so we know that the launcher is still alive for the connector. If that is not the case, we will just launch a new one. Connectors are separate processes, so in order to log it, it's sometimes a bit difficult as well. And we want to make it easier for implemented for connectors. So there is a mechanism for the connector. You have to implement it or implement a specific contract to log to this particular contract, and it will actually be consumed by the application, so the application can log it. And then it's up to the application where to log it. It can be like in a file, it can be to the event system, or like application inside of AppDynamics or whatever. Then it's up to the application where to log. So then you can also see in your main application what basically goes wrong in your connector. So you don't have to write a particular file to disk on that machine, which you cannot access maybe, but there's a general mechanism for logging your information and see how it goes.
So that means what we're trying to achieve is open up a few extension points to this new integration framework. So we're going to start with ECL, External Content Library, and the new Public Content Service. And in future versions, we're going to look into other kind of integration points. And the idea is that you write the connector, and that can be used both in ECL and in the content service context, and for future extension points as well.
So talk about extension points. The first extension point we're going to use is for using this connector framework or integration framework is the external content library. So the external content library can work currently with their own providers, but we make it also possible now to use the new connectors. And that way, from the UI point of view, nothing has changed, but we can actually now consume those new connectors in the external content library.
Yes, precisely. And you can also consume Java connectors through ECL, so that's also a nice thing to have. And as I mentioned before, we're going to introduce support for that in a new content service. That means that you now can do GraphQL queries towards external data. Take the next slide, please. There's a few new operations. New operation for query, you can query for either one external item or several external items using a filter. You can also do mutations, which is a name for write operations in GraphQL terminology. So for example, you can create a contact, update a Salesforce account, etc. You can also get a list of available namespaces that have been registered. Namespaces like external namespace, for example, Hybris, YouTube, Salesforce, etc., that you can access through GraphQL. So here's a few examples. So here is one request to query an Hybris database. So here we search for all products that have flagship Tripod in the name of type product, use some pagination, and I get a list of available products. I can easily select what kind of data I want to have for the product. That's the beauty with GraphQL. You can yourself define what kind of fields you want to have in the response. And GraphQL is self-documentary, so you can find all the information about the data model exposed by the connectors. For example, here you get all the information about the product data model exposed by a Hybris connector, in this case, that you can use in your queries. In addition, here's another example of querying a YouTube connector, in this case, listing a YouTube folder and get a list of various YouTube videos. And here is one example of getting a single Hybris product using a specific ID. Either you can use this kind of composed identity or an ECL URI if you have a reference to that in your content. In addition, we're going to also introduce the possibility to do mutations, allowing you to do operations through GraphQL, for example, in this case, create the Salesforce contact and pass a number of parameters. And that request is then passed to the connector itself.
Okay, just to summarize what we actually talked about, the 3D integration framework, it's a bit agnostic. So we basically don't care if you write your connectors in Java or in C Sharp. The connector is based on a contract, and the contract also exposes some capabilities. So it's up to the contract or to the connector to support it. So if you have a capability like creating a contact, then it should actually also be able to register the capability, hey, I can actually create an entity. So in that way, you have also more control what your connector can do. We have support for the external content library for connectors and also for the content service. And also it is possible to transfer the same item from the content management side to the delivery side. So for example, if you have a Hybris connector, you can use that Hybris connector on the content management side. You can navigate to it. You can even select the particular product. That information of that particular reference is stored in the content manager. Through publishing, it goes to the content delivery side. And there it can be picked up on the web application. You have the particular item ID. You can contact the GraphQL endpoint. And then using the same connector that is registered with the content service, be able to retrieve the right information about the pricing and the images and show that on your website. So also the connector, you can write it once and it can be used on the content manager side and on the content delivery side. And it does not really matter if that connector is written in Java or C Sharp, it will run on both systems.
Yes, so here's, I'm gonna describe a few integration scenarios where we can use the connectors for. So for example, commerce, as Ivo mentioned before, the whole mashup that you can mash up commerce data and content in Tridion, take references to products, categories, and build up pages by that and publish to the delivery side. You can also link, for example, to products categories, and that maybe generates like a concrete detail page on the delivery side. You can build experiences for campaign pages, category pages, etc., using this technology. Possibly you can also tag content with product SQI and do hybrid navigation, etc. When it comes to CRM, there's a number of scenarios, for example, building up CRM forms to collect leads and contacts. You can personalize content using CRM data, using the personalization engine to use CRM data to personalize your content on pages. You can use the CRM data when, for example, the form is posted, when you log in, maybe if there's a tracking cookie, then the CRM data can automatically be fetched and you can consume that in your web app, etc. Yep, next slide. In addition, there are a few scenarios, for example, if you do market information campaigns, similar scenarios, for example, mashup of content, forms create and campaign tool, doing like lead capture forms, tracking of activities, triggering of customer journey events, etc. And for multimedia, for example, manage assets content from one single interface, publish the assets to a website. You can mark assets as used in the external media repository like a DAM. So the DAM system knows that this asset is in use, so it can't be removed, for example. Handles different localization scenarios. You could also do like real-time galleries using the GraphQL service to query image matching a certain category or a tag, for example. So those scenarios, we plan to build a number of integration accelerators like with a set of out-of-the-box modules and example modules, for example, the example storefront for commerce, some example templates, etc., to make it as easy as possible to use those connectors in a Tridium context.
Okay, now going back to the connector. So what are those connectors and what are they based on and what is actually the contract we will keep referring to? So the contract is basically, it's a bunch of interfaces you have to implement. And also if you implement a connector, you have to create some entities. And an entity is something like a product or a video or a user. And that way you can also, that's the base of the system. So you can request for that entity, you can update the entity or delete the entity. We also have support for binaries. And binaries is something like a special case at the moment. So your entity can contain a binary, but the binary is actually a binary reference. So when you actually consume it from the GraphQL endpoint or on the ECL side, you get the entity with links with a binary reference to the particular binary. And then if you want to display the particular binary or get the content, we ask the connector with the binary reference to retrieve it from the remote system. So in that way, if you only need the entity, it is pretty fast. If you need a reference, that's actually another separate call for retrieving the binary. But it's also up to the connector to supply this information about the binary. It should actually transfer the whole content. We also have support for schemas, and schemas is very important on the ECL side to display the external metadata. And on the GraphQL, it is important to show the in the GraphQL on the schema, you can actually see then the product with the particular items in that schema. How you actually use the schema, it's basically on the entity itself. On the entity, you can decorate the properties with the schema field. And you can also decorate the entity itself. We will come back to that later to get it more clear how it's going to look like. We also have search in our connector, so you can actually search for a particular item, like Nicolas showed for Hybris, for instance. We also have association, so you can actually link to an item on a remote system and vice versa. So if we're going to delete something, we can notify the remote system, hey, we're going to delete this particular item, do you agree, yes or no, and that way you can block it. Or the other way around, if you're in the remote system, you're going to want to delete something, you will see, you can contact through the connector, hey, does it have a link, and you're not, you can say true or false, and then basically it's up to you how you handle it. This is a bit about the data model. So everything is based on an entity, and we have special ways actually of entities. An entity itself is basically enough maybe for the content delivery side, for the content service. But if you want to consume it in the content manager of site, it needs a little bit more. If you want to display it nicely in a list, we need some extra information, like it's like created by, created at, last modified. And it also would be nice to have a view URL as well. So if people want to click on the item and want to view it, like for the Hybris one, they want to view the whole product, and maybe the remote system supports it with a particular URL for that item, you can display it very nicely in a tab. You can open it and see how it is. That's for normal content. That is also something like multimedia content, and multimedia content, we really want to know, hey, what kind of content type is it? Is it like a JPEG or a TIFF? Like the file name, and also the binary reference I talked about. And the binary reference is later used to an article to retrieve the binary itself. And we also have an option to actually store variants as well. We don't do anything with it yet, but it's there available in the product. So for example, you can have a link on the CM side to this particular entity for the particular image. And on delivery side, you can retrieve that the same information about the same item on your DEM system, and then make a conscious decision of using a particular variant for it. So that's up to the connector and the implementer how to do it. We have entities itself. We have also container items. So sometimes you have folders that does not contain much, but is nice for navigation. And so we make a clear distinction. And you can also, if you want to get the list of items, you can also want to say, hey, I want to have only the entities, or I also want to have containers there as well. So it's up to, it gives more and more flexibility to implement it. So I talked already a bit about the entity identity. So we have an ID, and that ID is basically the identifier of the item of the remote system. We have a locale ID, and on this case, in these scenarios, we use the publications for it. But maybe later, if you're going to use this 3D integration framework, maybe for translations, it makes sense basically to have the locale of the particular language there. 3DN site is not really aware of languages at the moment, of locales. We have DXA that supports it, and we have a translation manager that supports it, but 3DN site itself doesn't have currently the notion of a language. We have the namespace identifier that's actually supplied by the connector, by configuration, through the connector manager, through the connector. So you actually get the namespace, and you should actually use that namespace. An entity can have a name. So the name is basically something like a video or a product in that case. And you have like a structure type. It can be the root, like if you want to navigate something, that's your main starting point of your application, it is the root. And it can be a container, and container can actually contain those leaves of other containers. In that way, you can actually build your navigation. The navigation on your remote system reflected in on our side, in the content manager, or on the delivery side. Then we have some key capabilities. So the capabilities mainly like getting an entity, you can actually list entities, and for lists we actually return paginated lists. So we also have support. Don't, if you're going to request or search something at 10,000 items, it doesn't make sense to return all 10,000 of them, but maybe in chunks 50 or something, and we have support for it. We have also support for mutation, so you can actually create entities, delete or update them, and also there's support for query them, basically. So querying is basically searching a particular entity. Here's again the binary reference. So the binary reference is actually also contains of the namespace ID. In the namespace ID is used also internally to know which connector it is we have to call. You can imagine in ECL or the contact service, you can have multiple connectors, and based on this namespace identifier, we know which connector to call. And for the type, you can actually define a type. It's like an icon or thumbnail, but it's only up to you. It's just a string, and you can do whatever you would like. And the ID is actually the identifier of the on the remote system. We also have like an iBinary, and that is actually what you return when you get that request to handle this particular binary reference. You should mainly return a binary, and the binary is actually stream content type and the length, and then also the browser knows basically how to handle it. And if an I download binary interface you have to implement it that actually refers to the binary reference, and then you can actually do your own manipulation, find out which binary it is and return it. We also have support for registering capabilities. So we have the notion of connector-wide capabilities, and connector-wide capability is something like downloading the binary reference or getting a list of the root items. And we have specifically type of capabilities for entities, and the entity is like get, delete, or delete. And you actually have to register those capabilities. So if your entity does not support delete or create, and they're not registered, we never call you, and we actually block it, block the call to you. So we don't have the notion, or we have the notion actually what your entity is capable of doing.
Yeah, so from a GraphQL perspective, for example, if you have registered a create and delete capabilities, that will automatically generate the corresponding mutations. So it's only the registered capabilities that are going to be available for user.
Yeah.
So the connector SDK. So apart from having a contract, which is just a set of interfaces, we have developed an SDK to make it easy to develop connectors, where it's easy to register capabilities, handle the pagination of lists, easy to build up schemas, either by class definition, or you build up your, it dynamically depends on what kind of data you are supporting. And as well support for different configuration you can have in your connector. So, and entity schema definition has the following fields, like name, description, a set of field definitions, and each field definition contains a description, what type it is, if it's required, is it read-only, and if there are any constraints like allowed values, regex, min and max values, etc. And here's a few examples, both from the C# world and the Java world, of how you can use annotations / attributes to define your data model. So you use plain C# Java classes to build up your model. Then you annotate, this is the field, this is required, this is read-only, this is a description, etc. And all the schema information is then automatically generated and registered to the connector manager.
So if you don't declare the property, it will not be there in your external metadata schema or in the
GraphQL
in the GraphQL data model.
Yeah. In addition, the connector itself can ask the framework for capability. There might be that the application itself can provide some capabilities, for example, create thumbnails, resize images, the kind of thing. So the connector can ask, is this capability available? Yes, okay, then it can use that. So that's a quite nice thing to have this bidirectional capability mechanism.
So it's actually up to the application that uses this 3D integration framework to supply this kind of capability.
Yeah, and the resize could then be implemented totally different ECL. Then we use ECL resizing, while on the delivery side, it could use the dynamic image delivery instead.
Okay, the renewed deployment. The current way we actually have for ECL is logging to the machine, copy a bunch of files, go to the external content library XML file, there at your mount point, save it, and hopefully it will work. And if you scale out scenarios of 10 machines, you have to do it 10 times. So that's why we are using the add-on service. So with the add-on service, you can easily package your connector and then upload it to the add-on service, and the add-on service makes sure it gets installed on all the different all the different products inside Tridion that actually knows what to do with the particular add-on. So in this case, like ECL will listen to this particular add-on for connectors, and also the GraphQL endpoint to content service will also listen to this add-on service for checking if there are new connectors to install. After you upload the connector, you also have to upload the configuration. And in the configuration, you can actually specify your remote endpoint, maybe some credentials. And there's also an option for maybe in staging your different URL done on live, you can actually configure this in this particular configuration file. And this is all done by the add-on service.
So here's an example of a configuration that could be passed into the add-on service with a few sections. Each section could be specific for each application, in this case, ECL and PCA. PCA stands for the Public Content API. And here you can have different configurations for those things. For the ECL, it might make sense to go to a staging hybrid instance in this example. And for the on the delivery side, you might want to go for a more high-performance endpoint. So you can have the possibility to have different configurations depending on where it's deployed. And as well, you can have a generic configuration, which is then overridden by the different application configurations.
So this is how it's going to look like with the add-on servers. You basically upload your add-on and this will be displayed nicely in a list. There will be a webinar about the add-on servers later this month. So I'm not going to go in too much detail about this add-on service. So actually, what did we talk about for the connector? So connectors are based on a contract, and the contract mainly consists only of interfaces. And in order to help our developers a little bit, we created an SDK. An SDK gives some extra support for speeding up implementing your connector. For example, you saw the schemas, how we handle it with the decoration of the attributes on the properties. Registering capabilities, we make that better, easier to use. And also what we're trying to consider basically is to have the SDK available on NuCat for the .NET connectors and the same on Maven for the Java version. And we're thinking about not only doing the SDK, but also maybe thinking about having a template ready. So for NuCat, for the C# connectors, and also in Maven for the
Maven archetype, yeah.
Yeah. So in theory, you can do something like .NET new, and then connector, and then give it a name, and then it's some kind of default or an empty connector with some information what you need to implement. We think that is also very nice to get started at least. And maybe we also published on GitHub like an example connector to have a reference and see how we implement it. And hopefully you will like it and get you up to speed. Connectors have isolation. So if the connector will crash, it will not crash your main application. We talked about the SDK. So we supply you with the SDK and also maybe with a template to get started creating those connectors. Configuration is separate from the connector. So the connector basically also maybe in the future we can put it on the App Store for SCL3DX. There you can actually download it, install it in the add-on service, but then you need some additional configuration like connect to your remote system. That kind of configuration is separate basically from your main connector. So your connector can be shared across multiple companies if you create a connector. And this is with the configuration, you can easily specify it for your needs, like I said, for talking to the remote system. And the deployment done is by the add-on service. So we make it possible for everybody to create those connectors, but also SDL with Nicholas's connectors team is also making those connectors. So you don't have to build everything yourself. You can also file maybe a request or contact the connectors team if you're interested in a particular connector. Maybe you have it in stock. Maybe it is there.
Yeah.
And otherwise, we can also help you maybe building it. Some webinars that are upcoming. So I was talking about already for the add-on for the development and deployment. And on the 14th of May, there's another webinar, Beyond STL Tridion Sites DXA 2.0. So basically, this was it for the presentation.
Yeah, I see there are a few questions that dropped in. So the first one, are there any out-of-the-box ECL integration developed for Tridion existing and headless CMS? An example would be an AM asset delivering images, PDFs, or content along with versioning and metadata into a Tridion component along with workflows. Yeah, we're going to make some out-of-the-box integrations available. To start with, we're going to deliver Salesforce CRM and Hybris Commerce, and a few others is coming, including a DAM connector. So it's, that will make it possible to use it both on the CMS and the delivery side and in headless scenarios.
What is the recommendation as to where connectors run, CM environment or CD environment? As an example, the CM environment is primarily .NET based, if the CD environment is primarily Java based and the connector is written in Java. What considerations should be made in deciding where to run the connector? It's basically up to you. We support both on both sides, so you can have a Java connector on your CM side, and you can have a .NET Core connector on your delivery side.
Yeah. So on the Java side, you can also have the connectors co-located in the content service. So if it's more kind of an delivery focus on the connectors, then it could make sense to write in Java, because then you can have that in the same memory space on the content service.
Another question was, is the old ECL provider still working? Yes, they remain working, the old ECL providers, and they also, we would love to make them also available by the add-on service. So currently you can only install them on the machine itself with updating the external content library XML file. That's still supported, but we also want to support the new scenario. They can upload like the old ECL provider with the add-on service, with its separate configuration, and also make that possible.
Yeah, I saw some other questions coming in, and for example, what Java version do you support? So we're going to support GDK 8 and OpenGDK 11 in 9.1.
Yeah. Okay. Are there any more questions from the audience?
Just type it in the chat.
Yeah. Okay, no, don't see any more questions popping up, so it's back to you, Kate.
Great. Thanks, Ivo, Nicholas, for presenting today, and thanks for everybody who actually attended the webinar. Just to let you know, the recording will be available here in Bright Talk straight after the webinar, but we'd also be sharing a copy of the recording to everyone who actually registered for today's webinar. We hope you found today's session useful, and we look forward to seeing you again on one of our next webinars. Have a great rest of the day. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.